Hi, so we are back with another session of weekly sessions, and today's session will be focused on different things, different interesting and fascinating things that you might have thought of learning or discussing. So was it for me. I also thought of discussing and learning about it, but time never permitted. So why not take the topics and complete them off and strike them off from a bucket list? So I'll be discussing today about what are the various optimization algorithms and some different techniques of transfer learning, as well as we'll be discussing about few methods or techniques which are used to improvise transfer learning. Apart from it, I'll be taking up a notebook example, two notebook examples rather than one. I'll be taking one notebook example from customer churn prediction, and another would be New York City taxi dataset sampling and other methods. So these are two different things which are widely popular. So everything is quite widely popular, and I think these must be discussed, and we will get to learn a lot. Yeah. So let's dive in. So where should we start? Let's start from the optimization algorithms. Here we are. If you visit the official resources, which are not official exactly, the ones which are provided by Keras, so you'll observe this. So what exactly it is? So basically it talks about optimizer is one of the two arguments required for compiling a Keras method, right? So you would require an optimizer and a loss function. Right? And how does an optimizer help? So what is an optimizer? Optimizer is a method which tells you how to update your gradients in order to reach the minima. Right? How to update your gradients, which in order update your weights, model weights, so that your model reaches the minima. In order to achieve that, what we do is we use an optimizer, right? We use an optimizer. So you can use directly for model.fit. If you are doing a custom training loop, if you're not using model.fit, what do we do in that case? In that particular case, you would define the optimizer and you would perform the apply gradients. So as you can see, you have calculated the gradients, and after calculating the gradients, you would do optimizer.apply gradients, right? This part is clear. Now let's talk about the various optimizers and what actually they are. So what is SGD, RMS Prop, Adam, Adder Delta, Addergrad, Addermax, NADM, FTLR? So of so many listed over here, what I actually know about is SGD, RMS Prop, Adam, Adder Delta, Addergrad. And I've never ever used Addermax, neither have I used NADM, nor I have used FTRL. Whatever these are, so the ones which are majorly used, the one which is majorly used is Adam, right? Adam is majorly used, then SGD is also used quite often. So is the case with RMS Prop. These are the optimizer algorithms which are frequently used and utilized. Now, what is an apply gradients method? Yeah. So we missed a point over here. So note that when you use apply gradients, the optimizer does not apply gradient clipping to the gradients. If you want to use gradient clipping, you would have to do it by hand before calling the method. All right, perfect. So these methods and attributes are common to all Keras optimizers, and so apply gradients to the variables, right. Optimizer.apply gradients. This is the second part of minimize. It returns an operation that applies gradients. The method sums gradients from all replicas in the presence of this TF distribute strategy by default. You can aggregate gradients yourself by passing this. Perfect. So you have calculated the gradients. Once you have calculated the gradients, you can apply the gradients. This is done. What we have, it is talking about the properties. The optimizer has the weights properties. It can obtain the weights and it can set the weights. Nothing much over here. Now let us visit the algorithms. Specifically the algorithms. So let's talk about SGD. What is SGD? So this is SGD. You have learning rate as a parameter, you have momentum as a parameter, you have Nesterov as a parameter. So gradient descent with momentum optimizer, update rule for parameter W and gradient G with momentum is zero. Right. Perfect. I don't think much would be discussed over here. So let's pick few of the optimizer algorithms. Let's talk about SGD, let's talk about RMS prop, and then we'll talk about Adam. And these are the most frequently used optimizer algorithms. We'll learn about them quickly and then we'll proceed to this article. Or we can start from this article, then we can proceed backwards, right? Yeah. So yeah, that would be better. So neither would I run out of content. So that would be my next topic of discussion in the next or upcoming sessions. One of the upcoming sessions, we'll take this up in one of the upcoming sessions. For now, let's read this article. Because I'll also run out of time. We have already taken up 5-6 minutes. So this should be wrapped up in next 5 to 10 minutes. Let's see. So what are the various optimization algorithms which are used for training a neural network? Right. So optimizers, what are optimizers? Optimizers are the algorithms or methods which are used to change the attributes of your neural network, such as the weights and learning rate, in order to reduce the losses. Perfect. So how should you change your weights or learning rates of your neural network to reduce this is defined by the optimizers, right? Optimizers define that in which order should you change your weights and the learning rates. That is something which is taken up by the optimizer. Now, optimization algorithms and strategies are responsible for reducing the losses and provide the most accurate results possible. We have gradient descent. Gradient descent is the most basic but most used optimization algorithm. It is heavily used in linear regression and classification algorithms. Right. So first thing, if you are entering into machine learning, the first thing you learn about is gradient descent. So what is gradient descent? Gradient descent is the most basic and the most used optimization algorithm, heavily used in linear regression, classification algorithms. Backpropagation in neural networks also uses a gradient descent algorithm. Gradient descent is a first order optimization algorithm which is dependent on the first order derivative of a loss function. It calculates that which way the weights should be altered so that the function can reach a minima. Through backpropagation, the loss is transferred from one layer to another, and the model's parameters are known as the weights, also known as weights, are modified depending on the losses so that the losses can be minimized. And this is the algorithm which we have already seen. So advantages: easy to compute, easy to implement, and easy to understand. But fallacies might be that it might get trapped at a local minima. Weights are changed after calculating gradient on the whole data set. So if the data set is too large, it may take years to converge to a minima and requires large memory to calculate the gradient on the whole data set. So then we came up with the idea of stochastic gradient descent. What is stochastic gradient descent? It is a variation of gradient descent. It requires to update the model's parameters more frequently. In this, the model parameters are altered after computation loss on each training example. If the data set contains 1000 rows of SGD, we'll update the model parameters 1000 times in a cycle instead of one time in a gradient descent. So what do you understand by stochastic gradient descent? So how the way you're proceeding with the data is the way you're updating your model parameters or your weights, right? So you're not doing it. Gradient descent is like go through the data set entirely. Once go through the data set, then you update your data set, right? But that is not possible for that has many fallacies. So we came up with something that is SGD, stochastic gradient descent. So what does it do? So how many samples you have, depending upon the number of samples, for each sample there would be an update made. So that is stochastic gradient descent. So obviously for every sample there is an update made, so you're remembering nothing. So nothing is being remembered. So what it is requires less time, may get many new minimas. The number of local minimas might be huge and converges in a way lesser time. But what happens is may even shoot after achieving global minima. So even if you have achieved global minima, it may shoot off. Added to it, there are high variance, and to get the same convergence at gradient descent needs to slowly reduce the value of learning rate. So there are some disadvantages associated with this. So an intermediate solution is what is known as mini-batch gradient descent. To be the best among all the variations of gradient descent algorithms, it has an improvement on both the SGD and the standard gradient descent. It updates the model parameters after a batch. So the data set is divided into various batches, and after every batch, the parameters are updated. So what are the advantages? Frequently updates the model parameters and also less variance, and requires an intermediate amount of memory. So by now, all the gradient descent have some inherent challenges, that is choosing an optimum value of learning rate. If learning rate is too small, the gradient descent may take ages to converge. If it's too large, it may jump off. Have a constant learning rate for all the parameters. There may be some parameters which may not want to change at the same rate. Yeah. So having a constant learning rate for all the parameters. So all the parameters might not be changed at the same rate. So this is also a problem, and you might get trapped at the local minima, which is a common issue. So what is momentum? Momentum was invented for reducing high variance in SGD and softens the convergence. Nesterov acceleration gradient, what? Alright, so I think we have taken up this article and let us complete this. So let it be. I might run out of content as I've had planned to take these for the next session, but let it be. Let us complete. So what is momentum? Momentum was invented for reducing the high variance in SGD and it softens the convergence. It accelerates the convergence towards the relevant direction and reduces the fluctuation to the irrelevant direction. All right. So it was invented for SGD, right? SGD, because for every data sample you are updating. So it might be the case that the deviation is high, which is always the case. The variance is quite high for SGD. So how to tackle that? With the help of momentum. Momentum, what it does is accelerates the convergence in the relevant direction and reduces the fluctuation in the irrelevant direction. This is denoted by a symbol, which is gamma. Gamma times this, weights are updated by this. Momentum term gamma is usually set to 0.9 or a similar value. Now, advantages are reduces the oscillations and high variance of the parameters, as well as converges faster than the gradient descent. But what is the disadvantage? One more hyperparameter is added, which needs to be selected manually and accurately, right? So, I mean, this is not exactly a disadvantage. I mean, if it is giving, I mean, you need to select it manually and accurately, I think. Yeah, so you cannot actually predict what the hyperparameter might be, but it's still better because it might help. If it helps with overcoming the shortcomings, then it's better. All right, you can consider it as a disadvantage as well. So now let's talk about Nesterov accelerated gradient. Momentum may be a good method, but if the momentum is too high, the algorithm may miss the local minima and may continue to rise up. So as to resolve this issue, the initial algorithm was developed and it's a look ahead method. We'll be using gamma Vt minus 1 for modifying the weights. So theta minus gamma Vt minus 1 approximately tells us the future location, and now we'll calculate the cost based on the future parameter rather than the current parameter. So cost would be equal to gamma Vt minus 1 plus the entire thing. Then update the weights. So energy versus momentum at a local minima. Energy would ask it to go over here. Momentum would ask it to jump off. Does not miss the local minima. Slows if minimas are occurring. Still hyperparameter needs to be selected manually. One thing which is not clear till now is how is energy beneficial from momentum, right? So I think it mentions over here. So momentum may be a good method, but if the momentum is too high, the algorithm may miss the local minima and may continue to rise up. So I think this is under the assumption that continuing to rise up might never lead to a global minima. Because in the previous session, we talked about the cyclic learning rate. So we always want to rise up from the local minima so as in the aspiration of reaching the global minima. But if this is the case, I think we will study a bit more about it, whatever it is. Now, one of the disadvantages of all the optimizers explained is that the learning rate is constant for all the parameters and for each cycle, right? This optimizer changes the learning rate and it changes the learning rate for each parameter and every time step t. It's a second type order optimization algorithm. It works on the derivative of an error function. is the learning rate which is modified for the gram parameter at a given time on a on based on the previous gradients calculated for the given parameter. We store the sum of squares of the gradients with respect to theta up to time step t, while this is a smoothing term that avoids division by zero. Interestingly, without the square root operation, the algorithm performs much worse. Nice. Now, it makes big updates for less frequent parameters and a small step for frequent parameters. This is, I think, good. This might be the feature that has made AdaGrad different from others. Now, what are the advantages? Learning rate changes for each training parameter. Don't need to manually tune the learning rate. Able to train on sparse data. This is good. Disadvantage: computationally expensive. Learning rate is always decreasing. Results in slow training. Ada Delta, extension of AdaGrad, which tends to remove the decaying learning rate problem. Instead of accumulating all the previously squared gradients, Ada Delta limits the window of accumulated gradients to fixed size w, and this exponentially moving average is used rather than the sum of all the gradients. Now, we set gamma to a similar value as the momentum term, around 0.9. And advantages: now the learning rate does not decay and the training does not stop. Computationally expensive. That is the common feature with everything. Now, we are about to discuss the one of the most discussed and the famous optimization algorithm, that is ADAM, adaptive moment estimation, which works with the momentums of the first and the second order. The intuition behind ADAM is that we don't want to roll so fast just because we can jump over the minimum, and we want to you don't want to roll so fast just because you can jump over the minimum and want to decrease the velocity a little bit for a careful search. In addition to storing an exponentially decaying average of the past squared gradients, ADAM also keeps an exponentially decaying average of the past gradients. MT and VT are the values of the first moment, which is the mean, and the second moment, which is the uncentered variance of the gradients. The method is too fast and converges rapidly, rectifies the vanishing learning rate, high variance, computationally costly. Now, if we are about to compare, we can see which one converges fastest. Green one, which is RMS prop. How is ADAM performing? ADAM goes, overshoots, then comes back. AdaGrad is extremely slow. What is AdaGrad doing? Is it expected? I think AdaGrad was the one which is introducing exponentially decaying learning rate. So you need not to tune in this. Alright, so that is why it is slow training. So the nearer it approaches, the slower it becomes. That is the issue with AdaGrad. Now let's talk about the red one. What is the red one? SGD. SGD is the one which is training for every row. So it comes next to RMS prop, which is RMS prop is also similar. RMS prop was alright, we have not discussed RMS prop. We have discussed ADAM, we have discussed AdaGrad, we have also discussed Ada Delta. How is Ada Delta performing? Quite good. So, conclusion: ADAM is the best optimizer if one wants to train neural network in less time and more efficiently. Then ADAM is the optimizer. For sparse data, use optimizers with dynamic learning rate. If you want to use gradient descent algorithm, then mini batch is the best. So if you want to use gradient descent, then use mini batch, and ADAM are usually the best. If you are going for something which is sparse dataset, we need to go for dynamic learning rate. Which one does support sparse one? Let's see. I think this is AdaGrad. Right? What is over here? I think this is the detailed implementation. I'll drop the link of this particular website. So let's assume we are done with reviewing optimizers. Now we proceed to something interesting, that is transfer learning. Our next topic is transfer learning, and this is a topic which you have already done or practiced multiple times, but let us discuss it again in the hope of adding something to our existing knowledge. What exactly is transfer learning we already know, but there are methods and some details which we might not have taken into consideration or we might have missed. So why not revisit the topic, and this is the idea. So we'll be revisiting the topic of transfer learning with the help of these three articles. These two articles and additional learning, how to use differential learning, that is something I'll be discussing, that is in additional learning. But this particular article is all about transfer learning. So what transfer learning is, how to utilize it, what to do. So we all know transfer learning, right? What is transfer learning? Transfer learning, the brief overview, what is it? It's like there's a model, trained model, weights you obtain, which was trained on a huge data set and achieved a great performance. Now you have your custom data set, which is quite similar, or it might be anything, but you want to utilize the pre-trained weights for your own model. So you don't want to start training from scratch, you want to use the pre-trained weights. In that particular scenario, it is transfer learning. But how to use the pre-trained weights, it is not as simple as it might seem. Yeah, it is simple to use the pre-trained weights directly, but if you refine and optimize or customize as per your need, you might obtain better results. So let us revisit the topic of transfer learning. So as the article says, how to quickly solve an image classification problem, right? Now, what is it? It talks about what is deep learning, this, that. All right. Then it says, this article shows how to implement a transfer learning solution for image classification problems, and the implementation proposed in this article is based on Keras, which uses the programming language Python. All right, perfect. So he says that the article is organized in the following way. First, he begins with this transfer learning, then he begins with convolutional neural nets, repurposing a trained model, transfer learning process, classifiers on top of deep convolution networks, examples, summary, references. What is transfer learning? Transfer learning is a popular method in computer vision because it allows accurate models in a time-saving way, obviously, because why to train from scratch if it is already done? So you utilize the pre-trained weights in order to achieve faster training and better performance. Now, in computer vision, transfer learning is usually expressed through the help of pre-trained models. A pre-trained model is a model that was trained on a large benchmark data set to solve this. This is something we already know. What is a convolutional neural net? So, convolutional neural net has two parts, a convolution base and the classifier, which is composed of a stack of convolution and pooling layers. Main goal of convolution base is to generate features from the image. Then we have classifier, which is usually composed of fully connected layers. The main goal of the classifier is to connect the image based on the detected features. A fully connected layer is a layer whose neurons have full connections to all the activation in the previous layer. So this is what it tries to say. It says that okay, all the convolution, the pooling and everything is the convolution base, and the rest is where you have the classifier, or what you say, the dense layers is something which we call as the classifier layer. One important aspect of these deep learning models is that they can automatically learn higher feature representations. This means that the features computed by the first layer are general and they can be reused for different problem domains, while the features computed by the last layer are specific and depend on the chosen data set and task. If first layer features are general and last layer features are specific, then there must be a transition from general to specific somewhere in the network. As a result, the convolution base of a CNN, especially the lower layers, refer to the general features and thus the classifier part. Some of the higher layers of the convolution base are referred to as the specialized features. Now let us talk about repurposing a pre-trained model. Wow. Now I think we are getting to the main topic. Till now we already know it was just a superficial revision or revisit. What does this topic talk about? So when you are repurposing a pre-trained model for your own needs, you start by removing the original classifier and you add your own classifier, obviously, because the original classifier usually, if it was trained on
ImageNet dataset, it would have 1000 classes, but we don't know, we might not need 1000 classes. So you remove the original classifier, add your own classifier. You have three strategies. You either train the entire model, you train some layers and leave the other frozen, and you freeze the convolution base. What each of them does, let's talk about it. If it is the case one, wherein you train the entire model, you use the architecture of the pre-trained model and train it according to your dataset. You're learning the model from the scratch, so you will need a larger dataset and a lot of computation power. Train some layers and leave the others frozen. As you remember, lower layers are general features, problem independent, whereas the higher level are specific features, problem dependent. Here we play with the dichotomy by choosing how much we want to adjust the weights of the network. Usually, if you have a small data set and a large number of parameters, you will leave more frozen to avoid overfitting. Okay, so if you have a small data set and a large number of parameters, you would leave the more layers frozen so as to avoid overfitting. By contrast, if the data set is large and the number of parameters is small, you can improve your model by training more layers to the new task since overfitting is not an issue. Now, this is the third aspect, right? Which talks about freezing the convolution base. This case corresponds to an extreme situation of the train freeze trade-off. The main idea is to keep the convolution base in its original form, then use its outputs to feed the classifier. You are using the pre-trained model as a fixed feature extraction mechanism, which can be useful if you are short on computational power. Your dataset is small, or pre-trained model solves a problem very similar to the one you want to solve. So what does this talk about? It talks about you are using a pre-trained model as a fixed feature extraction, alright, which can be useful if you are short on computational power and your data set is small, or the pre-trained model solves a very problem similar to the one you want to achieve. Alright. So first strategy is train the entire model, second strategy is partially train, third strategy is only train the convolution, freeze the convolution base. This particular strategy would be used in the case where your short on computational power and your dataset is small. Dataset is small, short on computational power, and the dataset is similar to the one you are solving to. This will be used So if you have a small data set and a large number of parameters, you would leave less number of layers frozen. If you have a large number of samples in the data set and a small numbers of parameters, then you can train more layers because the concept of overfitting would not be there. And in this particular case, you need a high computation power. So unlike strategy 3, whose application is straightforward, strategy 1 and 2 require you to be careful with the learning rate used in the convolution part. Yeah, because we are not dealing with the convolution part over here, so we need not to be concerned with the learning rate. But if it's the case of strategy 1 and strategy 2, we need to be careful with the learning rate. The learning rate is a hyperparameter that controls how much you adjust the weights of your network. When you're using a pre-trained model based on a CNN, it's smart to use a small learning rate, because high learning rates increase the risk of losing previous knowledge. Assuming that the pre-trained model has been well trained, which is a fair assumption, keeping a small learning rate will ensure that you don't distort the CNN bits too soon and too much. Now let's talk about a practical perspective of transfer learning. This would be very interesting, I hope so. This chart is extremely popular, and I think this is where the article should ideally end, but we will continue till the bottom, because we won't be going through the code example and everything. We'll skim out the essential parts. Now, what is the essential part over here? Essential part over here is this. So the entire transfer learning process can be summarized as follows. Select a pre-trained model. From the wide range of pre-trained models that are available, you pick one which looks suitable for your problem. For example, if you are using Keras, you immediately have access to a set of models named like VGG, Inception V3, ResNet 5, and here you can see all the models available in Keras. Classify your problem according to the size similarity matrix. In figure 3, you have the matrix which controls your choices. This matrix classifies your computer vision problems considering the size of your dataset and its similarity to the dataset in which your pretend model was trained. As a rule of thumb, you consider that your dataset is small, and if it has less than 1000 images plus per class regarding the dataset similarity. Okay. Classify your problem according to the size similarity matrix. What are these? I think this is a process which it asks to follow. First, you need to decide your pretend model. Then you need to identify the type of task you have, the problem. So in figure 3, you have the matrix that controls your choices. But in figure 3, this is the matrix which controls the choices. All right. This matrix classifies your computation vision problem considering the size of your dataset and its similarity to the dataset of your pretend model. As a rule of thumb, consider that your dataset is small. If it has less than 1000 images per class regarding the dataset similarity, let common sense prevail. For example, if your task is to identify cats and dogs, ImageNet would be a similar dataset because it has images of cats and dogs. However, if your task is to identify cancers, this ImageNet can't be considered as a similar dataset. Alright, perfect. So this matrix is our guiding principle, guiding matrix. But for this, what is a large and what is small, what is similar, what is different? Large is anything which is beyond 10,000, which is beyond 1,000 image samples per class. Small is anything which is less than 1,000 images per class. Similar is something which is having a high similarity index, or what do you say? The data set, the model, pretrained model was trained on. And different is something different from the data set which you're having, which is different from the one the pretrained model was trained on. So this is our guiding quadrants, but we will revisit it once we start talking over, once we go through this. So fine tune your model. Here you can use the size similarity matrix to guide your choice and then refer to three options we mentioned before about repurposing a pretrained model. Figure 4 provides a visual summary of the text as follows. We have four quadrants, quadrant 1, quadrant 2, quadrant 3 and quadrant 4. Each of the quadrants have their guiding principles, but how do you deal? So this is something I would ask you to learn by heart. So what is quadrant 1? Is a data set size and how you train the model. That is what it is. So in quadrant 1, what we have? What we have in quadrant 1, we have, if your data set is large and but is different from what the pretrained model was trained on, then in that case you need to train your entire model. If your data set is large but similar, then train some of the layers, specifically the last layers, which is problem specific. If your data set is small and different from the pretrained layer, then you need to train some more layers. And if it is small and similar, then in that case, just train the final layers. Coming to classifiers on top of deep convolution neural networks. And this is basically what happens is you have a convolution base and above it you add a classifier layer, right? And the classifier layers is custom depending upon the data set or the task you have on hand. So what kind of classifiers we usually add are basically these three points. You can do something else as well, but these are the most common ways to deal with the classifiers which are to be added on top of convolution base. First, it's either a fully convoluted layer. Second, it is either or it can be a global average pooling. Third is a linear SVM model. A linear SVM model is a good popular choice for your YOLO models. Now, coming to this is example and implementation, but we will get into the depths and other details in the upcoming session. I'll keep this for the next session, not now, because we're running out of time, as well as that would be too much. So till now, you just go through, revisit what I've talked about, what I've discussed in this session, in this article. This article is a lot. So just remember the quadrant, what to do, when to do. This is all about it. Now let's move to our interesting article. The interesting article is understanding learning rate and how it improves the performance. We have been learning a lot about learning rates for the past few sessions.
But this particular session is dedicated to differential learning rates. And what differential learning rate is something quite fascinating. Now, in cyclic learning rate, you were changing the learning rate, right? In cyclic learning rate automatically decreases in Adam optimizers. Now, in cyclical learning rate, you had a specific manner and design to change the learning rate and also to find the initial learning rate to train on, the best learning rate to begin the training with. However, if we talk about differential learning, what is differential learning? So differential learning rates are basically you are applying a different learning rate to different parts of the neural network. All the parts of the neural network should not be trained with the same learning rate, else it might lead to the breaking of the weights, unnecessary breaking of the weights, because the low level or the initial layers are not meant to learn the complex features. They learn the low level features. The idea is they need not to learn the complex features and they need not to update their weights so frequently as the other layers need to do or the top layers need to do, which just task specific. The bottom layers are, they are independent of the task. They are the low level general features, edges, vertices, corners, those kind of things. So that is the idea. So you divide the entire architecture into different 3 parts, 4 parts, 5 parts, depending upon your convenience. But the bottom parts should have the smaller learning rate and the end parts should have the larger and the optimal learning rate. It can be 3 groups, it can be 4 groups, it can be 5 groups, depending upon your convenience as well as the size of the network. However, that is the idea of this particular article and the brief overview. The intuition behind this method of the computation is that the first few layers would typically contain very granular details of the data, such as the lines and edges, which we normally wouldn't change much and like to retain some information. As such, there's not much need to change their weights by a big amount. In contrast, in later layers, such as the ones in the given above, green above, we get detailed features of the data, such as the eyeballs, nose, mouth, and we might not necessarily need to give them. So, how does this compare to the other methods of fine-tuning? It is argued that fine-tuning an entire model would be too costly and some would have more than 100 layers. So, what people usually do is fine-tune a model one layer at a time, but this is a sequential requirement and hinders the parallelism, therefore resulting in overfitting for a small data set. This is the brief overview. Now, let's get to a detailed overview. What is this article talk about transfer learning using differential learning rate? So, how do you do it? The most general way of doing it is by modifying the dense layers such that the network output suits a task at hand and train only the newly added network. This. Alright. So it talks about the most general way of doing. How do we actually do is modify the dense layers, final dense layers, such that the output suits to a task at hand and train only the newly added layers. Right? What we do is model VGG, let's say we imported VGC, so VGG equal to TF Keras pretend this TS Keras applications dot VGG 16 and you get the pretend model, then on top of it you add few layers. So what you do is VGG dot trainable equal to false and then you for other layers you do it as a true. So this is the most common way and this works if you have a small amount of data and the data is extremely similar to the one the pretend model was trained on. Now coming to the second approach, it is to include the convolution blocks closer to the tense blocks. This is more ideal if we have a medium-sized dataset and the tasks are not so tightly related. Alright. So this particular second approach talks about including the convolution layers for training as well, so that if it is basically this is used if the tasks are not so tightly related, they are not so good, they are not so correlational and the data set is medium sized, so you might love to include the convolution blocks for training. Third approach is to use a pretrained model but to train all the layers with the data set. This is an extremely large data set you would require. So one thing is extremely clear, with the increasing number of layers, the size of the data set required would be increased and so would be the computation, right? So as well as if you increase the number of layers to be trained, the similarity of the data set you're training should be reduced significantly from the data set the pre-trained model was trained on. So these are the two conclusions I can infer from these paragraphs. Now let us hear about this paragraph. It is about mixing the first and third approach. If we decide to use a third approach, it is better to apply the first approach for some epochs. First approach is training the last few layers so as to bring the newly added layers weights to a better point, and then we can unfreeze all the layers and follow our third approach. This is also equally good. We'll explore a bit about it. What exactly is differential learning rate? The phrase differential learning rate means to have a differential learning rate for different parts of the network during our training, and the idea is to divide the layers into various layer groups and set the learning rate for each group so that we get the ideal rates. Perfect, 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 perfect. How does this help? If you consider the third approach above, there is a small but significant point to be noticed. To understand, let's go back to a sample scene and figure, and in general layers in red, generic features, this. Given our statement, it is not a good idea to change the learning rates on the initial layer too much because they have already good what they're supposed to do, still have a knowledge of the complex feature, which might help with the task to some extent. We might slightly modify them. Differential learning rates help with the regard. We can now imagine sample network in three layer groups and set the different learning rate. So the initial red layers will have small learning rate as we don't want to disturb them. Middle blue layers will have greater learning rate, and the last layers would have the highest optimal learning rate. How less or more the learning rates for initial and middle layer depends on the data correlation between the pre-trained model and our model required, right? If the task is to create a dog and cat classifier and our pre-trained model is already good at recognizing cats, then we can use a learning rate of less magnitude. If our task is to create some model on satellite imagery, then we have learning rates of slightly higher magnitude. So please note that most of the deep learning libraries currently don't support differential learning rates. Okay, so let me show the code. I'll write up a detailed post on coding. Conclusion: depending on the task at hand and resources, one should choose an appropriate approach in transfer learning. In general, we have a good amount of data and resources. Transfer learning with differential learning rates will yield better results, obviously. Next time, we will search for a code example and a practical implementation for this. Since we have some time, let's explore this. Now let us explore this. Let's not keep it for the next time. Let's explore, get it done. Point number 6, in this example, we'll see how each of this. So what is this? This is the one which we were talking. So classifiers on top of the deep learning neural networks, right? So there are three types of classifiers which are usually added. Now let's get to the examples. In this example, we see how each of these classifiers can be implemented in transfer learning solution for image classification. Comparing the performance of different classifiers on top of deep convolution networks requires further investigation and thus makes an interesting research direction. This is perfect, and let's prepare data. In this example, we use a smaller version of the original dataset. This will allow us to run the models faster, but it's great for people who have limited computation power, like me, also like me. So to build a smaller version of the dataset, we can adapt a code provided by Chole. I don't know how he pronounces his name. Panquiscole. Whatever it is. Let's focus on the code example. What the code example is about. It is about creating a smaller dataset for cats and dogs. We are not concerned with creating a smaller dataset. Let's get to the main part. Extract the features from the convolution base. The convolution base will be used to extract features. These extract features will be fed to the classifiers. So extract features, labels, generator, data generator, pass the feature, predict, convolution base, predict the inputs, features, you have the labels, and you have the pain features, validation features, test features. Now let's get to the classifiers. So this is a simple way to train a model. You have the model or sequential, you add layers, and you begin training, right? It's good. Brief description of the results. Validation accuracy 0.85, encouraging given the size of the dataset. Model strongly overfits. There's a big gap between training and validation curve. Since we already used dropout, we should increase the size of the dataset to improve the results. Global average pooling. The difference between this case and the previous one is that instead of adding a full stack of fully convoluted networks, we add a global average pooling layer and feed its output to a sigmoid layer. Note that we are talking about a sigmoid activated layer instead of a softmax one, which is which is what is recommended by this. We are changing to the sigmoid activation because in Keras to perform binary classification, you should use sigmoid activation, not binary cross entropy. Therefore, it was necessary to do this small modification to the original proposal. All right. So discussion is validation accuracy similar. However, the model does not overfit and loss function is still increasing. What happens in the case of linear support vector machines? In this case, we will train a SVM classifier on the pieces extracted. To train a classifier, a traditional ML approach will be preferable. Consequently, we'll use K-fold cross-validation to estimate the error of the classifier. Since K-fold cross-validation will be used, we can concatenate the train and validation sets to enlarge our training data. Code 5 shows the data we can concatenate it. So that's what it is. Summary. So they introduced 3 different classifiers that can be used on top of the features extracted from the convolution base and provided an end-to-end example of image classifier for each of the 3 classifiers. That is what the summary is. I think this is great and this is understandable. So how did this session go about? We started off with optimizers. How are the optimizers, how they help, what are the different kind of optimizers, and their algorithms, what they mean, how they proceed. Then we started with an interesting topic of transfer learning, what is transfer learning, and in general what transfer learning is this article. Then we proceeded to what is differential learning. So today's article was all about optimizers, transfer learning, differential learning. Today we didn't get time to talk about code examples. We'll take that up in the next session. Till then, take care, bye-bye, and do hit the subscribe button so that you get timely notifications about what is happening in my channel and what I'm about to post. All right, take care, bye-bye.